Hey, Shalom Israel, it's Kanai.
Marbiel.
And we're going to go over a topic of tithing. This is a topic that has come up quite often, and many of you so-called Christians, and I use the word so-called because to be a follower of Christ or call yourself a Christian, you must be observing and doing as the Lord and Savior has done. So when I say so-called, it's because you follow the religion, Christianity, instead of following the teachings of our Lord and Savior. Anyway, back to the point. You go to church, you give your money away, thinking that it's bringing you closer to God. You're under duress by these fake pastors telling you that if you do not sow a tithing, that you will not receive the kingdom of heaven and you will not be blessed. Okay. That's a lie. All right. And we're going to begin showing that tithing has been done away with. Now that we're under the mercy of our Lord and Savior, you have things called free will offerings, and you give according to you can afford to whenever you want to. All right, let's begin. Let's start the book of Malachi, chapter 3, verse 8. The reason why we're starting the book of Malachi is because this is the scripture that is used to make many of you feel guilty for not giving. Read.
Malachi, the third chapter and the eighth verse. Will a man rob God? Yet ye have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offerings. Ye are cursed with a curse, for ye have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven, and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it.
So that's what they tell you. See, if you give your tithe, that you will receive a blessing from God. And earlier said that, how have you robbed God? By not giving your tithes. Now mind you, I want many of you to think about this. Christianity I'm talking about. Christians, so-called. That in Christianity it's taught that it's okay to eat whatever you want to eat. You can worship God and still eat pork, shrimp, crab, even though it's found in the dietary laws. And then when these points are brought out, what's being said was that's the Old Testament. That's done away with. We're under the mercy of Christ. But we're reading now tithing, which is also an Old Testament scripture. Notice how these lying pastors, they pick and choose what from the Old Testament they want to hold on to and what they let go of. You can eat pork, but you better give your money. Now the point of tithing, was tithing ever monetary? No. Tithing was only the first of your fruits, your oils, your cattle. It was never monetary. Let's begin. Let's go to the book of Exodus chapter 29:24.
Exodus, the 29th chapter and the 24th verse. And thou shalt put all in the hands of Aaron, and in the hands of his sons, and shalt wave them before a wave offering before the Lord. And thou shalt receive them of their hands, and burn them upon the altar for a burnt offering, for a sweet savor before the Lord. It is an offering made by fire unto the Lord. And thou shalt take the breast of the ram of Aaron's consecration, and wave it for a wave offering before the Lord, and it shall be thy part.
Right. So, this offering was to be given to the sons of Aaron, and the reason why is because they did not have a inheritance with the other tribes. Their inheritance was to serve the Most High, and in doing that, the rest of the tribes were to sustain the tribe of Levi and Aaron's son. All right. From there, I want to go to Deuteronomy chapter 14. Verse 22.
Deuteronomy, the 14th chapter and the 22nd verse. Thou shalt truly tithe all the increase of thy seed, that the field bringeth forth year by year. Yeah. And thou shalt eat before the Lord thy God in the place which he shall choose to place his name there. And the tithe of thy corn, of thy wine, of oil, of thine oil, and the firstlings of thy herds and of thy flocks, that thou mayest learn to fear the Lord thy God always.
Notice, everything here that was named had no, this has nothing to do with currency or money. Read on.
And if the way be too long for thee, so that thou art not able to carry it.
And the reason why this way be too long, because the Most High commanded in Deuteronomy 16, verse 16, that three times a year all males must appear before the Most High, and they must not come empty-handed. They had to bring a sacrifice or the tithes back to Jerusalem. So now if you were not able to bring these animals, because many of the Israelites were dwelling all over, somewhere in Babylon, Egypt, wherever they might be, what would they do? If read verse 24 again.
And if the way be too long for thee, so that thou art not able to carry it, or if the place be too far from thee, which the Lord thy God shall choose to set his name there.
What is that place he chose to set his name? Jerusalem. Read on.
When the Lord thy God hath blessed thee, then shalt thou turn it into money, and bind up the money in thine hand.
So then you turn your animals, your crops, you sell it, and you turn it to money, and you take that money in your hand. Read on.
And bind up the money in thine hand, and shalt go unto the place which the Lord thy God shall choose. And thou shalt bestow that money for whatsoever thy soul lusteth for.
And what you're going
to... I'm sorry, lusteth after.
Right, and what you're going to do when you get to the land, you're going to take that money, and you're going to go and buy whatever your soul lusteth after, meaning whatever you desire. So if you desire oxen, sheep, turtle doves, whatever it might be, you purchase those things. Read on.
For oxen, for sheep, or for wine, or for strong drink, or for whatsoever thy soul desireth. And thou shalt eat there before the Lord thy God, and thou shalt rejoice, thou and thine household.
Read on.
And the Levite that is within thy gates, thou shalt not forsake him, for he have no part nor inheritance with thee.
So what do you do with that money? After you sell your stuff, you go back and repurchase it in Jerusalem, and then you offer up the offering and give a tenth of that to the priest. So you can't say, and this money currency stuff is nothing new. They had shekels back then. They had currency. They never gave the priests money. Because many of you would say in Christianity that, well, we don't have animals to sustain us. We don't do that anymore. Those were for that time. No. That's not. The God prescribed what's to be offered. They sold their stuff, received money, and they never handed money to the priest. And mind you, you had to hand your offering to the Levites, the sons of Aaron. Not anybody could have been a priest. Not anybody could fill that office. You had to not even be a Levite only. You had to be a son of Aaron, because you could have been a Levite and not necessarily be a son of Aaron. If you were not a son of the sons of Aaron, you could not fulfill this office of high priest that offered up sacrificing. So who is the sons of Aaron today? Where are you men out there that's not? Where is the temple in Jerusalem standing? Because the temple had to build a temple there. The temple fell in 70 AD. Under Titus and Vespasian, and it was never rebuilt. So it says in a place where God chose. So if you in Kentucky or Oklahoma or Florida or New York giving some man your money, you're not doing as God prescribed. It had to have been in Jerusalem. It had to have been to a Levite. And it had to have been the first thing of your flock, cattle, wine. And if it's not, then you're not doing as God prescribed. We're trying to show you that whole tithing thing is a lie. It's being taught to you that you all can give your money to these men and they can line their pockets. And lying Christianity is teaching you this.
That's right.
Let's move on. All right. So we're going to go and show you how that tithing custom ended when Christ died and resurrected and went back to the Father. Christ being the sacrifice ended and ushered out the old covenant, which was a covenant of sacrifices, and ushered in the new covenant, which is mercy through him. All right, let's go from back to the book of Hebrews. For many of you, do you understand the difference between the Old and New Testament? It's very simple. Many people think the laws of the Old Testament are done away with, and the New Testament is just by faith. have to keep the commandments. That's another lie. The only thing that's done away with from the Old Testament is the whole Levitical order of the priestly's job, the priest's job, the sacrificing, the tithing, the head coverings for the males. What else was done away with?
The priestly garments, like with the breastplates.
Right, those things are all done away with. Let's begin. The book of Hebrews, chapter 7, let's start with verse 1.
Hebrews, the 7th chapter, and the 1st verse. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation king of righteousness, and after that also king of Salem, which is king of peace.
So if anybody knows the story, Abram went to war to recover his nephew Lot. And when he came back from the war, he came and brought a tenth to Melchizedek. So tithing began even before the Levitical order was even in place. We read about tithing here, or offering from them. So what was happening, the priests, the Levites, were trying to hold on to this office as this is the way to God, by giving us a tenth of your land, a tenth of your cattle. And the book of Hebrews and this chapter was written specifically to explain to those Jews that were still in Jerusalem that you were not being saved, or you were not righteous, because of sacrificing and holding on to Levitical order. Now, through Christ dying, his blood was that perfect sacrifice that brought us back to the Father. Read on.
Verse 3. Without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God.
Right. He was made like unto Christ. He had no beginning of days, no end of days, and Abraham came and brought a tenth of sacrifice to him. Read on.
Abideth a priest continually. Now consider how great this man was, unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of the spoils.
Now it says, consider how great he was, that even Abraham gave the tenth of the spoils to Melchizedek. Read on.
And verily, they that are of the sons of Levi, who receive the office of the priesthood, have a commandment to take tithes of the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, though they come out of the loins of Abraham.
Right. And the sons of Levi, who received the office of the priesthood, when they received the office of priesthood? After Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Then came Moses later on, and after Moses came the tribe of Levi, which the tribe of Levi came out of there, and Aaron got the office. That was until the time of the Exodus. Abraham was back in Genesis. Mm-hmm. It says, and even them, according to the priesthood, was commanded to take a tithe, even though they came out of Abraham's loin. Even though Abraham paid tithe to King Melchizedek, that was not a Levite. Read on.
Verse 6. But he whose descent is not counted from them received tithes of Abraham, and blessed him that had the promises.
Right. But he whose descent is not counted from them received tithes of Abraham. Who is that? Melchizedek. He received tithes of Abraham, it said, and blessed him that had promised. And he even was able to bless Abraham. Read on.
Verse 7. And without all contradiction, the less is blessed of the better.
Right. And without all contradiction, the less, which is Abraham, is blessed of the better. Which was blessed of who? Melchizedek. It showed that Melchizedek was considered better than Abraham, in that he blessed him. Whose office was to bless in the time of Levites? The priest. The priest blessed the people. But Melchizedek, who was not a Levite, blessed the patriarch, Abraham. Why is this being written? Why was this letter written to the Hebrews? To let them know that the Levitical order is done away with. And with that ending, it ended the sacrificial law, it ended tithing. All that is to be showing them that that is not the way. Christ is the way.
That's right.
Let's read on.
Verse 8, and here men that die receive tithes, but there he receiveth them of whom it is witness that he liveth.
Right. It says, and here men that die receive tithes, but there he receiveth them of whom it is witness that he liveth. The high priest, they die. The sons of Levi, they come to him and they die. But guess what? But there he receiveth them. But who? Christ receiveth them of whom it is written that he liveth. Because Christ rose back from the dead. Why is he using this analogy? Because it's showing that Christ became the true high priest. The priest that you have died, but Christ, he received those when he died. He forever lives. I want to go to that scripture. What was the scripture you pulled before St. John's?
St. John's, I believe it's 8.
8. St. John 8, verse, what verse you want to start with? 37.
The point is all the way down in.
I don't care. To move, you want me to start it?
Start it. 37.
Okay, I'll start. I'll read it for you. St. John's 8:37. I know that ye are Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me because my word have no place in you.
So this is Christ. Christ was speaking to those people that were gathered there at that time. I would believe it was the Pharisees, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he was telling them, he says, I know that ye are Abraham's seed, but ye seek to kill me because my word have no place in you. He was letting them know there was no light in them. They were off. Those Israelites was wicked. He says, my word has no light in you. It has no place in you. Read on.
I speak that which I have seen with my father, and you do that which ye have seen with your father.
So he says, I speak that which I have seen with my father, and ye do that which ye have seen with your father. He was basically telling them, ye of your father the devil. Y'all off. Y'all wicked. He's doing, Christ said, I'm doing what my father told me to do. Read on.
They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said unto them, if ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham.
He says, so if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. When we're going to get down and find out, he's subliminally telling them that Abraham followed me. Abraham did right. Read on.
But now you seek to kill me, a man that hath told you the truth, which I have heard of God, this did not Abraham.
So he said, but now ye seek to kill me, a man that have told you the truth, which I have heard of God, this did not Abraham. Abraham didn't do what y'all are trying to do. Abraham didn't try to kill Christ like y'all are trying to do. Y'all are trying to persecute me. Y'all are trying to have me put to death. Your father Abraham didn't do that.
Let me say something.
Yeah.
Abraham didn't try to kill Melchizedek. He honored Melchizedek.
That's right.
And Melchizedek was not a Levite. He didn't come from the descent of Levi. Abraham honored him in giving a tenth and giving him the reverence. And he was the better than the less. As we just read. Read on. I'm sorry, read. Verse 41. You do the deeds of your father. Then said they to him, we be not born of fornication. We have one father, even God. Jesus said unto them, if God were your father, ye would love me. For I proceed forth and came from God.
Hmm.
Neither came I myself, but he sent me.
So basically Christ is letting them know. They're saying, we weren't born of no fornication. They were trying to say, we weren't off. We wasn't born worshiping other gods. We worship God. But Christ is letting them know. If that was the case, you'd be following me. You'd be believing in me right now. Read on. Jump down to verse 52.
Verse 52. Then said the Jews unto him, now we know that thou hast a devil. Abraham is dead and the prophets, and thou say, if a man keep my saying, he shall never taste death.
So the Israelites were basically saying, oh, you got a devil on you. Because the way that he was speaking in terms to Abraham, now he said, if a man keep my saying, he shall never taste death. Basically, what they're saying, you got a devil because you're making yourself seem like you're more than Abraham. Read on.
Art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead?
So that's what they're asking. Are you greater than our father Abraham, which is dead and gone, which is passed on? Read.
And the prophets are dead, whom thou makest thyself.
Read on.
And Jesus answered.
52.
Verse 52. Then said the Jews unto him, Now we know that thou hast a devil. Abraham is dead, and the prophets, and thou say, If a man keep my saying, he shall never taste death.
So the Israelites were basically saying, Oh, you got a devil on you. Because the way that he was speaking in terms to Abraham, and he said, if a man keep my saying, he shall never taste death. Basically, what they're saying, you got a devil because you're making yourself seem like you're more than Abraham. Read on.
Art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead?
So that's what they're asking. Are you greater than our father Abraham, which is dead and gone, which is passed on? Read.
And the prophets are dead, whom thou makest thyself.
Read on.
And Jesus answered, If I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom ye say that he is your God.
So this is Christ giving the Most High all glory and honor. He says, If I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom ye say that he is your God. Christ is cutting them again. Y'all keep saying that y'all believe in the Most High, but you're not believing on his Son. Read on.
Yet ye have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say, I know him not, I shall be a liar, like unto you.
Mm-hmm.
But I know him, and keep his sayings.
Read on.
O Father Abraham, rejoice to see my day. Read that again. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad.
So this is Christ telling those Jews, he's telling them, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day. Wait a minute. How did Abraham rejoice to see his day? Back in, what is that, Genesis 12? Were you going through that already?
No, go through it. Let's get that real quick.
So for one, Genesis 12.
Saying what?
When he gave him tithes.
Genesis 14.
That's right.
Genesis, when the king brought forth the bread. Genesis 14, verse 18.
That's it.
Okay. And Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine, and he was the priest of the Most High God. And he blessed him and said, Blessed be Abram of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be the Most High God, which have delivered thine enemies into thy hand. And he gave him tithes of all.
So this is Abraham giving Melchizedek, like we was reading back in Hebrews, tithes of all. Christ told those Jews that was there, he said, Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. What did Abraham do when he saw his day? He gave him tithes of all. So when we go back to John, Verse 56 again.
It says, Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day and he saw it and was glad. Then said the Jews unto him, Thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham?
So the Jews is like, you ain't nothing but 50 years old. You say you seen Abraham? You ain't even 50 yet, and you saw Abraham our father. Read.
Jesus said to him, Verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am.
Mm. So Christ was there at that time. Christ was Melchizedek, like the brother's going to bring out in Hebrews 7.
That's why I said Melchizedek, he had no beginning of days, nor end of days. This might be a lot for many of you to digest that don't understand these scriptures, that don't understand that the Most High, when Christ said, I'm Alpha and Omega, he's telling you something very, very deep. And the point in all that is that Christ was saying, if you honored your forefather Abraham, then you would honor me, because Abraham was honoring me.
That's right.
That's what he's trying to tell you. And that's why he said, I was here before Abraham. So let's go back. We're in Hebrews 7, what verse was that we left off in?
We left at verse
7 again.
Yeah. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 7. And without all contradiction, the less is blessed of the better.
Right, the less. Abraham was blessed of the better. Who? Melchizedek. You know, the son of God. Mm. Who else was the Son of God? Christ was called the Son of God. Read on.
And here, men that die receive tithes, but there he receive of them of whom it is witnessed that he liveth.
Read on.
And as I may say, Levi also, who receiveth tithes, paid tithes in Abraham.
Right, and Levi, the sons of Levi who received tithes, they paid tithes in Abraham. Read on.
For he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him.
Why? Because Levi was in the loins of his father Abraham when Melchizedek met him. So you Levites, you that are trying to hold on to this tithe thing, don't you know you all were subject to pay tithe through your father Abraham to Melchizedek, who was not a Levite? So why are you trying to hold on to this tithing thing? Why are you trying to hold on to the sacrificing thing like it's something that's necessary for salvation? It's not. You can't. Remember, you were paying tithes. In other words, you were still in the loin of your fathers, in your daddy's sacks. That's the point you're trying to say. And Abraham wasn't his father. That was his great-grandfather. He's the grandfather or great-grandfather. And you paid tithes through your own loins. To who? To Melchizedek. Read all that.
Verse 11.
So I'll make a point. The whole point behind that is to show you that, guess what? There was one greater than you Levites that were taking tithes. And he's back. And once again, you have to step out your place and honor him. It's no longer your way. So this is to debunk and take apart that foolish fallacy that in these days that you must pay tithes. How is it that you go in your congregations and you give a tenth of your earning to a pastor that's driving around expensive cars and you're footing his bills and fly around the country? The shepherd is supposed to tend to the flock.
That's right.
Not the flock tend to the shepherd. Christ fed the people and took care of them. The tithes that come in, or the offerings, I should say, that come into church, it should be used to maintain the church and to help the poor of the congregation. Not to put a $5,000 pen in that lying prophetess Juanita Bynum's hand. She don't belong up on the podium in the first place, because the Most High didn't command a woman to stand and teach men, or teach a congregation, I should say. Not saying that we don't have prophetess in the last day, but not to lead off a congregation. You have Bishop T.D. Jakes and Bishop Long, Eddie Long, and Creflo Dollar, and all you lying pastors that milk the congregation saying that you're robbing God by not giving money. Mm-hmm. And the rest of you are duped because you don't read your Bible and don't apply God's laws to get the understanding thereof. Read on.
Verse 11. If therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood.
So perfection was by the Levitical priesthood. What was part of the Levitical priesthood? We just read that you paid tithes. So perfection was by paying tithes, by sacrificing.
For under it the people received the law.
Right, because under it people got the law that they have to give a tenth of their earnings. Read on. Of their crops. Read on.
What further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek?
Then what was the point of Christ rising then? If sacrificing made you perfect, if tithing made you right with the Most High, absolved you of your sins, then what would have been the need of Christ coming? It would have been no need. That was just to show you that it was never perfect. Sacrificing was never made you perfect. Tithing never made you perfect. Yes, it was a law to be kept back then, but when Christ came, he abolished all of that. Now, that doesn't mean he abolished all the commandments. He abolished the Levitical priesthood. And now we're going to be a nation of priests. But no longer do you have to bring tithes. No longer do you have to go to Jerusalem three times a year. The temple was destroyed. Now it's believe on him in the keeping of the commandments. You know.
And not be called after the order of Aaron.
Read that verse again.
Verse 11. If therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law. What further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron?
So another priest rose up like Melchizedek, but was not called after the order of Aaron, how it was set up. Show that before the sons of Aaron, there was a high priest. And after the sons of Aaron was going to be pushed out of their place, there was going to be a high priest. And neither one of those two high priests came out of the sons of Aaron.
That's right.
They superseded that. Read on.
Verse 12. For the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law.
Right. Well, so now here we go. Lying Christianity says, see, the priesthood's changed, now the law's changed. The only law's changed is what? What was just reading above that? About giving tithes. Tithing. When the priesthood changed, the changing of the tithing changed. No longer did you have to bring it to the priest. Then no longer did you have to... You have to understand the reason... change, the changing of the tithing change. No longer did you have to bring it to the priest. Then no longer did you have to, you have to understand the reason why tithing went off is went on because that's how the priest was sustained. They didn't have an inheritance of land. So it was the obligation of the other tribes for their welfare. That's why God set up like that. So they can take their tenth to feed themselves. But when the priesthood changed, they went out of business. Christ took over.
Sure.
He became the high priest. And that's why they wanted to get rid of him. One second real quick. I'm looking for that scripture where it says, they move us out of our place. The Romans.
Oh, that the Romans would come?
Yeah. Bear with me, everybody.
And this also shows you dealing with the Levitical order. A lot of your pastors will claim, and even amongst Israel, a lot of people have claimed that, you know, you got to pay us tithes. And what you see, what's taking place is they're trying to pull things that the Levites had. They want to pull the benefits of the Levites and try to take on. And they say, oh, we're a nation of priests, so we're supposed to get the same thing to leave. But that's not what the scripture said. The Levitical order has been done, taken away. Like you read in 1 Corinthians 11, how we're not supposed to cover our heads. You read in Levitical order, the priests covered their heads. The men did have head coverings back then. But now, you're showing dishonor to Christ if you have your head covered, claiming that you're the priest and this, that, and the third. You're dishonoring Christ because you're trying to bring back that Levitical order, which didn't save us in the first place. You're showing honor unto that.
John 11, verse 47. Right, and that's for, now this part is for our brothers that are, that have women that are in the church that don't have their head covered when they pray and prophesy. We'll get to that in a second. That, and the men that have their heads covered, you're dishonoring your head, which is Christ, ultimately. That mitre, the head covering for men, was part of the sons of Aaron's dress code to serve in the office of priesthood. When Christ doing away with that, Paul made it clear that that was no longer to be followed. And those that followed that was openly saying, symbolically saying, that they reject the Messiah.
That's right.
That's why Paul said you can't pray or prophesy with your head covered. And women cannot pray and prophesy without their head covered. Do that, is that foul today? Many of you don't do it. No, not at all. Let's go to St. John's 11, verse 47.
St. John's, the 11th chapter and the 47th verse. Then gathered the chief priests and the Pharisees a council and said, what do we? For this man doeth many miracles. If we let him thus alone, all men will believe on him, and the Romans shall come and take away both our place and nation.
This is showing one thing, that the Israelites were under the subjection or captivity of the Romans. The Romans controlled who was in power. Like today, in this government, you all, really, I mean, many old people, you're so disconnected from the truth. You think Obama is running something? You think Obama, just because he sits in a position of the President of the United States, that mean anything? No. He's still under subjection to the powers that be, that run the inner workings of this world, of this country. Just like the Jesse Jackson and Al Sharptons, you think Al Sharpton, these guys, and the Creflo Dollar, these men, they'll be pushed out of the way. They'll be pushed out the way. And that's the same thing back there. Who were the leaders of the Israelites back then? The Pharisees, the Sadducees, the priests. These would be the Jesse Jackson and the Al Sharptons of today. What was their worry? If we let him alone, if we let the Christ alone, all men will believe on him. And if they leave the Israelites alone, all men is going to start changing. So they're going to start afflicting the Israelites also. It's no different. You're going to drink of this cup if you call yourself Israel. Teaching that America is not your homeland. America is not blessed by God. America is not the land of the free, the home of the brave. Here you are in subjects to payments. You were brought as slaves. And back then, these Pharisees were worried about what? That if we let him thus alone, all men will believe on him, and the Romans shall take and come, the Romans shall come and take away both or place the nations. The Romans are going to come and move us out of a position. Now them in that position, what was going to do? Take away their livelihood, the offerings that were coming, how they fed, how they took care of themselves, how they made their money. Hebrews 7. Verse 12.
Hebrews the 7th chapter, the 12th verse. For the priesthood being changed, there is made a necessity, a change also of the law. For he of whom these things are spoken pertaineth to another tribe, of which no man gave attendance at the altar.
Right, this is from the tribe of Judah. No man gave attendance at the altar from the tribe of Judah, because they weren't set up for that, you know.
For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning priesthood.
Right, and Moses spoke nothing concerning priesthood for the tribe of Judah. But even though he didn't speak about the tribe of Judah playing working at the giving attendance at the altar, even though Moses didn't speak about it, it was already known that that whole Levitical office was just for a dispensation of time. And when that office ended, when our Messiah rose from the dead and resurrected, that did away with the ushering in of the new covenant, doing away with tithes and sacrifice. That's what the whole book of Hebrews is talking about. Read on.
Verse 15. And it is yet far more evident, for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there ariseth another priest.
Right, after similitude, meaning similar to Melchizedek, there arises another priest, which is Christ.
Who is made not after the law of a carnal commandment, but after the power of endless life.
Right. Who was made not after the law of a cardinal commandment, but after the power of endless life. He wasn't made after the order of what? To follow the sacrificial laws. Let's go from that to Hebrews 5 real quick. 5:1.
Hebrews the 5th chapter and the 1st verse. For every high priest taken from among men is ordained for men in things pertaining to God, that he may offer both gifts and sacrifices for sins.
Yeah.
Who can have compassion on the ignorant and on them that are out of the way? For that he himself also is compassed with infirmity.
Right, because that priest also was compassed with infirmities. Read on.
And by reason hereof, he ought, as for the people, so also for himself, to offer for sins.
Right, so this priest, this high priest, called the Levites, the sons of Aaron, they had to offer sacrifices for their sins also. Remember, the high priest's job was to go into holies of holies, sacrifice to the Most High, to ask to absolve the nation of Israel of their sins. But at the same time, he had to offer up sins for himself. Go back to Hebrews 7, verse 16.
Hebrews chapter 7, verse 16. Who is made not after the law of a carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life.
Right. The cardinal commandment is what? This was a man that was a sinner. He wasn't made after a man that was a sinner that was going to die, but he was made that perfect sacrifice.
That's right.
That was going to have endless life. So if that was no need for him to come, then guess what? The old covenant of sacrifice would have made us perfect, which it couldn't. Read on.
Verse 17, for he testifieth that thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek.
Right, because who prophesied that? Go to Psalms 110. Psalms 110. Verse 1.
Psalms chapter 110, verse 1. The Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool.
So the Lord is who? The Most High said unto my Lord, this is David speaking. The Most High said unto his Lord. Who was David's Lord? Christ. David had prophecy of the Messiah also. This whole thing about the Messiah is nothing new. It's prophesied throughout the Old Testament over and over again. The Most High said unto my Lord, which is David's Lord, which is Christ, sit thou
at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy
right. Who said the right hand of the Most High? Christ. Read on.
The Lord shall send the rod of thy strength out of Zion. Rule thou in the midst of thine enemies.
Right. And that rod which is Christ, he's going to rule sternly. People got the wrong impression of Christ. Christ ain't coming back to play. They said his garment will be dipped and his vestments shall be dipped in blood.
That's right.
Like Christianity teaches that, oh, it's going to be a day of joyfulness and rejoicing. No, it's not. It's going to be a day of weeping and gnashing of teeth. The righteous shall scarcely be saved in that day. Hmm. Read on.
Verse 3. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power, and in the beauty of holiness from the womb of the morning. Thou hast the dew of thy youth.
Yeah.
The Lord hath sworn and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek.
God has sworn it to who? To Christ. Let's go back. That's where it was prophesied. That's what we're reading in Hebrews, where it was drawn from. So even David himself understood that. Read on.
Hebrews chapter 7, verse 17. For he testifieth, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. For there is verily a disannulling of the commandment going before the weakness and unprofitableness thereof. For the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh unto God.
Right. For verse 18, for there is verily a disannulling of the commandment. There's a doing away with the commandment. What commandment? The whole Levitical order concerning the sons of Aaron and the priestly order. That's what I wanted to say. That all the pomp and what went on for the priestly office was to be done away with. It's being disannulled. It says, going before the weakness and unprofitableness thereof. Because really, it was unprofitable. It never made you perfect. Even though God commanded us to do it, it never made us perfect. We just read that earlier. Because verse 11, if therefore perfection were made by the Levitical priesthood, what further need was there of another priest to rise after the order of Melchizedek? So it was unprofitable, really. You were just rehearsing a righteous act in doing that back then. Read on.
Verse 19, for the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh unto God.
Right, so the lying churches want to say, see, the law never made you perfect. The law has never made you perfect. Is talking about what? Just keep in the context of the chapter. Tithing, sacrificing, never made you better. But that hope, which is Christ, made you better. So sure, those other commandments aren't done away with. That's not done away with eating pork, shrimp, crab, lobster, celebrating Halloween or Christmas.
New Year's.
And when you want to put that new name behind Christmas, say, well, really, it's not that. You know, it's us. Seeing what the angels, when the star came and the wise men came and bring gifts, you try to fit circles and squares. The one thing you won't do is humble down to God's word and do as prescribed. God nor Christ ever prescribed that. And there's so much research outside of the Bible that tell you that it's a day of worshiping pagan gods. You have to be so disconnected from reality to think that that has anything to do with the birth of Christ. Read on.
Verse 20. And as much as not without an oath, he was made priest.
Read on.
For those priests were made without an oath, but this with an oath by him that said unto him, the Lord swear and will not repent, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek.
Right. The oath was not made with the Levites, meaning there was not an oath made with them, meaning it wasn't like something that was agreed upon or the Most High said will last forever. But the oath to last forever was made after the order of Melchizedek, which was Christ. He was going to become the high priest forever. He's telling them back then that your office you hold as a Levitical, the sons of Aaron, was just a dispensation of time. It wasn't meant to be forever. It wasn't. Read on.
Verse 22. By so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament. And they truly were many priests, because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death.
Right. They said, and they truly were many priests. There were many high priests, because they could not continue because they died. They were corruptible. Read on.
But this man, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood.
Right, but Christ, he continued ever, he'll forever be the high priest because he never dies. Read on.
Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them.
Right. It says, wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost, meaning to salvation forever, that come unto God by him, that come to the Most High by acknowledging him that he's the Messiah, seeing that he ever liveth and make an intercession for them. So when you pray, you must go through Christ. But how do you love Christ? Do you just pray to Christ and don't do what Christ said? Christ said, if you love me, keep my commandments, and my commandments are not grievous. He said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and you don't do the things I say? So you must be keeping the commandments, but you must let go of the tithing and feel that you're condemned by it and the sacrificing.
Verse 26.
I'm saying, but as long as you feel that you need to do that to make you righteous, you deny your Lord and Savior.
That's right.
Read on.
Hebrews chapter 7, verse 26. For such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens, who needeth not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice, for his own sins, and then for the people's. For this he did once when he offered up himself.
Right, Christ did that once. You don't need a priest to do that daily, because the office of the priesthood, sons of Aaron, that was a daily job. He said, no, once with Christ. Read on.
For the law maketh men high priests which have infirmity, but the word of the oath, which was since the law, maketh the Son, who is consecrated forevermore.
So it says, for the law maketh men high priests which have infirmities. Because the law of the sons of Aaron, these men have infirmities. They're sins, they're sinners themselves, they die. It says, but the oath, the promise, which was since the law, meaning from when? From the beginning, maketh the Son, who is consecrated forevermore. Read on. I'm sorry. I'm gonna go from that to Colossians real quick so I can touch upon this. Colossians. What's Colossians? There we go. Colossians 2. Verse 16.
Colossians, the second chapter, in the 16th verse. Let no man therefore judge you in meat, or in drink, or in respect of an holy day, or of the new moon, or of the Sabbath day, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ.
Okay, so now people read this and they think that, you know what, see, let no man judge you therefore in meat. You can eat whatever you want to eat. Now we're in the New Testament. You can't judge me. You can't judge me if I want to eat pork. Let no man judge me in drink. You can't judge me if I want to drink. So what if I want to wake up in the morning and have three shots of Hennessy start my day? Let no man judge me in respect of holy day. You can't judge me if I want to celebrate Halloween with my kids. It's about SpongeBob and candy or Christmas. You can't judge me in that. Only God can judge me. This is what you hear from Christianity. Mm-hmm. And I keep on touching Christianity because the religion of Christianity is a lie. Christ, nor the apostles, nor God commanded Christianity. To you want to know what a Christian is? You're looking at them right now. Christians are those that follow Christ wherever he goes. Christ said, keep the Sabbath, we'll keep the Sabbath. Christ said, don't. Christ said, keep the Christ kept the high holy days, we'll keep the high holy days. Christ kept the commandments and wore a beard, we're going to wear a beard on face. We're not going to eat pork, just like Christ didn't eat pork, because Christ was sinless. Now, are we going to make mistakes? Yes. But it's repentance. Not willfully breaking God's commandments, like Christianity tells you, you women can wear whatever you want to wear. Wear pants, hooker skirts, whatever. Just believe on Jesus. You men, you can go there with daggone lip gloss, popping gum, singing as like doing damn Beyonce routines, effeminate. And don't worry about it. Blood of Jesus absolves you of that. That's a damn lie. You can celebrate whatever you want, and God is going to love you. It says, let no man therefore judge you in meat or drink or respect of a holy day or the new moon or the Sabbath day. See, I go to church on Sunday. God said, I don't have to, you can't judge me because of that. It said, which are shadow things to come, but the body of Christ. Now we're going to go back a little further in the chapter and explain what it's talking about. It's going to tie back to Hebrews and the whole Levitical order. All the sons of Aaron, their priesthood. Start with verse 14.
Colossians, the second chapter and the 14th verse. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross.
Right. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. What was the handwriting of ordinances that was against us? The sacrificial law. They were against us. Why? They never made you perfect. Commit adultery is a law in the bathroom. Is that against? I mean, committing adultery is in the Bible. Is that against you? The law of committing adultery? Thou shalt not murder. Is that against you? Let's prove. Hebrews 9. Hebrews 9, verse 1, and then jump to verse 10.
Hebrews chapter 9, verse 1. Then verily the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service and a worldly sanctuary.
Right. Remember that word ordinance? It says, then verily the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service and a worldly sanctuary. What was that sanctuary? That was built up in the time of Solomon that God commanded in the city that he set forth, Jerusalem, as a city. And in that city you had a sanctuary. And what did they do in the sanctuary? They had the diverse washings that went on. They had the table, the candle, the shoe bread and the candlesticks set up, the menorah. It was set up a specific way. Read on. Verse 10.
Which stood only in meats and drinks and
bodies. Start with verse 9.
Hebrews chapter 9, verse 9. Which was a figure for the time then present.
Right. And all that divine service was a figure for the time then present. For the time back then. Read on.
In which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect.
Right. But in that you had to give gifts and gifts and sacrifices as God commanded in the Bible. The Most High commanded in Deuteronomy 16. In Numbers 28 or 24. You had to bring these offerings, but it never made you perfect. Read on.
As pertaining to the conscience.
Right, because guess what? You gave that, but as pertaining to your conscience, guess what? If you didn't change your mindset, you're still wicked. You can give all the offerings, like in baptism. Many of you all, I've been baptized 42 years through the blood of Jesus. I'm born again. I'm gonna get the kingdom because I've been baptized. No, baptism, water baptism, is just symbolic of the true baptism, which is supposed to be the baptism of your mind, repenting. Because if you take a man that's a murderer and you go get him baptized, all you have is a wet murderer or a wet thief. What has to change? This. And what changes your mind? God's law is what changes your mind. Show you right from wrong. It's a sin to hate your brother. It's considered murder. It's a sin to steal. It's a sin to commit adultery. It's a sin to be a homosexual. It's a sin to celebrate these pagan days. Until you reform this, you're not born again. What is a religion called born again? Foolishness. Read on.
Verse 10, which stood only in meats and drinks and divers washings.
So what is, read verse 8 into 9.
Verse 8, the Holy Ghost.
I'm sorry, no, verse 9 into 10.
Verse 9, which was a figure for the time then present in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect, as pertaining to the conscience, which stood only in meats and drinks and divers washings, and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of reformation.
Right, it was imposed on the people to do what? Meat offerings, drink offerings, divers washings, the ways the priest had to wash, and cardinal ordinances imposed. What were some of the cardinal ordinances? That if you had to see if copulation leave you, when your sperm, you slept with your woman, you had to wash and be unclean until the evening before you can go to the temple. A woman was on her menstrual cycle, she had to move out of the house or separate herself from her husband for 7 days until her menstrual cycle passed. All those cardinal ordinances was imposed on them until the time of reformation. What does the word reformation mean? To the time of change. When did that time come? When Christ came and he did away with them and he became the high priest out of the tribe of Judah, which was not for Levi. And to explain to the Hebrews, the Spirit showed them through these prophets and through the apostles, they took him back before the Levites and showed them that you all were paying tithes through your father Abraham to Melchizedek. So don't try to hold on and think that the tithing is something you have to you. No, it's done away with. Go back to, read on.
Verse 11. But Christ being come and high priest.
But Christ became the high priest. Remember, the high priest was from Aaron.
Of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands. That is to say, not of this building.
Because the people thought that you had to go to, see, the temple is in Jerusalem. You must go. And many of you think the church dwells within you. It's not a building. And definitely not back in Jerusalem. Let's go back. Colossians 2. Let's read verse 14 now.
Colossians, the second chapter, the 14th verse. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us.
So what was the handwriting of ordinances that was against us? The sacrificial law, the tithing. Read on.
Which was
the sacrificial law.
Which was contrary to us.
It was contrary to us because it never made us perfect. Read on.
And took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross.
Right. He took that out of the way when he nailed to this cross. Why? Because no longer did you sacrifice. He was the ultimate sacrifice. He was that perfect sacrifice that Moses was speaking about that was going to come. Moses spoke about him in Deuteronomy 18:18. Isaiah spoke about him in Isaiah 53. We just read about him in Psalms 111 or 110. It was 110, right? 110. Mm-hmm. Read on.
Verse 15. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it.
And he made a show and having spoiled principalities and powers. How did he spoil them? By coming back from the dead. Because many of our brothers back then that was wicked thought that, oh, we put the Messiah to, we put Christ to death. And he spoiled them, showing them, listen, I told you I was the Messiah. And after 3 days, he rose and he was seen of many people. He spoiled their plans and came back. Read on. And made a show of them triumphing over them. Who are the ones that, to triumph mean he beat them, he won. Who was those that wanted him dead? Caiaphas, the high priest, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Levites. He triumphed over them. He won. And he showed them, I am the way. No longer do the people need to go through you and your sacrifice and your tithing. I'm the way. Follow me. That's what Christ was trying to show them. Read on.
Verse 16. Let no man therefore judge you in meat.
This is the understanding. Therefore, because he triumphed over them, and no longer do you need to follow the Levitical order, you need to follow Christ, then the man can't judge you in a meat offering. That's the same thing we read over here in Hebrews 9 and 10, which stood only in meat and drinks and diverse washings. Therefore, because Christ's away, now don't let a man judge you and say, you wicked because you didn't bring a meat offering to the temple. Or what? Drink
or in drink,
or you can bring your drink offering. Remember, it says you buy strong drink or wine when you came back. You didn't bring an offering, you didn't come to Jerusalem 3 times and bring your offerings. Don't let no man judge you and call you wicked because of that. Read on,
or in respect of unholy day.
So, what would you bring when you bring a meat offering, drink offering? You would bring a tithes. That was what tithes was, the tenth of what? Your meat, your drink, your crops. Don't let no man judge you if you don't bring these things to them, or to what?
Or of the new moon.
Or the respect of an holy day. Because how did you respect a holy day? On different days of the week, they had different sacrifice. On different high holy days, there were different sacrifice that you brought. On a holy day, on a new moon, or a Sabbath days. Because all these days, when you read the scriptures, will prescribe different types of sacrifice. No man can judge you as evil because you didn't bring a sacrifice. It had nothing to do with you not keeping the days, honoring them. But you didn't have to honor them by sacrificing or bring tithes. Read on.
Verse 17, which are a shadow of things to come.
All those sacrifices was just a shadow of the true sacrifice to come, which was Christ. Read on.
But the body is of Christ.
Let's go to Hebrews 10 real quick. Let's just explain that last part. Hebrews 10, verse 1.
Hebrews, the 10th chapter and the first verse. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come.
What law? The sacrificial law had a shadow of good things to come. We just read that in here. Which were these sacrifices, which were a shadow of things to come. So the laws having a shadow of good things to come.
And not the very image of the things.
So the law of sacrifice wasn't the very image of the true sacrifice. It was just a shadow of what was going to happen. It was just a shadow of the true sacrifice, which was Christ that was going to come and die for you. Show you that it was only for dispensation of time. Read on.
It says, and not the very image of the things can never, with those sacrifices which they offered year by year, continually, make the comers thereunto perfect.
Right. Those sacrifices could never make you perfect. So you now breaking your back to give tithes to these lying pastors, you got to be joking. You got to be joking. Keep your money in your pocket. Find teachers that's going to teach this word freely. Freely as you receive, freely as you give, God commanded. It is wicked to charge a person to hear this word. To perform a funeral, to perform a wedding, you got to pay. And you all just, like the sheep led to the slaughter, giving your money away. Mm-hmm. Christianity is a lie. It's a lie. And I'm being blanket for Christianity right across the board, because God never commanded any religion. He commanded believing on the Son Christ in the keeping of the commandments. So I hope that this was edifying to you, brothers and sisters, and you took something from it. Giving all honor and glory to the Heavenly Father and our Lord and Savior, Christ, we want to say shalom.
Shalom.